May the Spirit of God be with us this morning. May the Word of God be heard in this place. And may all the other words flow away like so much chaff on the wind. Amen. A couple of years ago, way back before the big sanctuary renovation work started, our planning team spent some time consulting the original blueprints for this room. The beams and the plaster that now seem as if they were set in place by the hand of God at the dawn of time were in fact conceived generations ago by architects experimenting with advanced technologies like electrical wiring. Businessmen, community leaders, the matriarchs and patriarchs of Des Moines' founding families reviewed those plans, refining and giving shape to their vision for the future of our church. And their legacy lives on in this very room. We call it our sanctuary. But the original blueprints designated it the auditorium. That word makes a difference. A sanctuary is a place to seek shelter and safety. An auditorium is a place to listen and to be heard. As an auditorium, then, this room has held the voices of choirs and congregation soaring in songs of praise. It has held the holy silence of our prayers. It has heard the cries of broken-hearted mourners. And the ancient truth of the gospel proclaimed anew in season after season. This is our sanctuary. We come here for shelter from the storms of life, but we also gather here to listen and to tell our stories. That's not always easy. Sometimes it's very hard. And yet, when we find the courage to tell our stories and to listen when it would be easier to tune out, something holy happens here. Fear loses a little bit of its grip on the world, and love wins a little more room to grow. This morning, Mark's telling us a story that I don't always want to hear. It's a story about a woman who comes to Jesus in the city of Tyre. And she asks him to heal her daughter. And he shuts her down. And he calls her a dog. And she asks for help again, pointing out that even the dogs get crumbs from the children's table. And Jesus says, for saying that, you may go. The demon has already left the dog. Maybe you can see why I don't always want to hear this story. Right? I think we need a little background. I'll warn you now, though, that the background won't make it a whole lot easier to hear. But it might help us make some meaning this morning. Let me tell you about Tyre. Tyre is a fairly affluent community. Right? There are property owners and government officials living there. The city has a port with good access to farm produce and traded goods. You could imagine that they have a Whole Foods and a Trader Joe's. Maybe even a Crate and Barrel. Okay? That's Tyre. There are different kinds of Gentiles living there, and there are some Jews. But the Jews are mainly artisans and laborers. They don't own the property. They work it. They hang the drywall. Okay? Now Jesus is in town, but he's not out there healing in the public square or teaching. synagogue. No, he's keeping his head down, and he's staying in a private room. Well, then Mark tells us this woman comes to see him. All he says about her is that she's a Syrophoenician Gentile, which means she's part of the dominant culture there in Tyre, and that she has a daughter. Now, Mark calls her a woman and not a widow, so it's reasonable then to imagine that she is married. That's all he gives us. Let's put this picture together. A socially prominent, well-positioned, at least, woman comes alone to someone's private home to see Jesus. An itinerant, working class rabbi. And she begs him to help her daughter. I'm guessing that this woman was desperate. And I bet you that her husband doesn't know she's talking to Jesus. She's probably scared for her daughter. And I bet she's long past worried what other people are going to say about her. She just needs help. And she believes that Jesus can help her. Now Jesus, you know, Jesus is usually eager to help, right? He stops the parade for blind beggars and paralytics and fishermen and prostitutes and lepers, but not today. Today we hear Jesus telling a desperate mother to head to the back of the bus. And I imagine he was irritated with her too, because he uses such strong language. Why should the dogs have the children's dinner? That's the kind of language he usually reserves for religious authorities. Harsh. But this mother hears him. She hears him saying that the vulnerable and marginalized come first in his book. And even so, she hands it back to him. She says, okay, I understand where I fit relative to all those people at the top of your list, but dear God, I need your help, please. For the sake of my child, please help me. She says, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. And so he agrees. Jesus tells her, for saying that, you may go. The demon has already left your daughter. This is a hard conversation for both of them. The child's life hung in the balance. They both stretched to hear and to be heard. I think they both learned something. In the end, fear lost a little bit of its grip on them, and love gained a little room to grow. I imagine that there was a lot of relief and some lingering discomfort in the days that followed. There is no further mention of the woman from Tyre. No indication that she was converted in any way beyond her acknowledgement that as one of the first, she ought to come last. I feel that lingering discomfort right about here, the tightness in my chest. The story is hard for me. It's hard for me to sit with it and listen again to those difficult words about who goes first and who comes after. That's partly because I identify with the mother who's so desperate to help her child. And from that perspective, Jesus' prickly response, it really stings. And there's something else here, too. I grew up with pictures of Jesus holding lost lambs and welcoming little children. And I guess in my imagination, Jesus is always really excited to see me. But this story makes me wonder, would he? Maybe he would. Maybe it would be more like that time I walked into the DMV with a lot on my mind, and I walked right up to the counter, and the clerk gave me a dirty look. There was that awkward moment when she pointed over my shoulder at the crowd already lined up around the room. Right? See, I just assumed I was first. But really, I was about 83rd in line, right? There's a little bit of that to the story, too. You know, if I were that one, I think it would have cost me something to sit with Jesus and to hear him tell me that my priorities aren't the same as his, that my emergency isn't his emergency. But someone else's is. Now, intellectually, I do understand what he's saying, but it still hurts to hear it. Hard conversations are often like this, right? They stretch us outside the comfort zone of familiar assumptions and introduce disorienting new information. A coworker resents something we've done or left undone. A sibling expresses anger because we've failed to help care for an aging parent. A friend tells you she feels taken for granted. Those aren't easy conversations to have. Most of us have them only rarely. And yet, if you reflect for a moment, you may notice that we so often grow because of them. We become more compassionate, or more attentive, or at a minimum, more aware of how our actions affect other people. When we listen well, we grow in love. And there are stories we rarely hear. A lot of times, those stories belong to people at the margins. People who live far from the centers of power, voiceless, ignoring. We rarely hear their stories. We never even, think about this, we never even hear the names of the people who make our clothes. That voicelessness, it's embedded our economy and in our culture at a level that seems almost primeval, just the way things are. Just the way things are. Friends, that kind of isolation is dangerous. You don't have to look further than the front page of any paper this week to know that more than one child's life hangs in balance today, because all is not well in the world for our neighbors this morning. It is vital that we hear one another, that we stretch to listen, even when what we hear challenges us, right? And that we tell our stories, even when what we tell takes courage to share. We could begin right here. What do we have to lose? Like Jesus and the woman from Tyre, we could sit down to share our deepest concerns. How race and class intersect with our juvenile justice system. How refugees see a world that's torn to shreds, grieving everything they held precious. What we hope for all our children. These are not easy conversations to have. They surface fear and guilt, wounds that have gone untended far too long, and fully justify anger. That's not easy. That is not easy. It pushes us into a new space where the familiar order is turned upside down and the old answers no longer fit. And not everyone will be able to know it. But for the life of her child, I wonder if this Syrophoenician woman would ever have come to Jesus. But for the life of her child, she did. She needed to ask him for help. And though it cost her something, she received it. Mark tells us that she went home and she found her daughter lying in her bed and the demon gone. So many of you already know this better than I do. In the course of a single week at Plymouth Church, there are dozens of people sitting down with refugees from Burundi, South Sudan, Eritrea, and Rwanda, piecing together connection across the vast divides of ethnicity, political conflict, language, and race. A space opens between us, and hope is born, where there had been heartbreak. Tonight, our Family Promise team will welcome two families with children experiencing homelessness. The children are 16, 10, 7, and then there are 2 5-year-olds and 2 babies. And all through this week, they will take shelter from the storm in the hospitality rooms right underneath our sanctuary. Brothers and sisters, beloved of God, the truth is this. We all have a lot to lose. And in this sacred work, we may yet lose our illusions, our isolation, and our fear. We may even lose some of the distance between us and between us and God. As we learn to speak the truth about our lives and to listen carefully, to hear the truth in others, we will grow in love of God and neighbor. And as stories are told and heard, fear will